my compliments to the chief for, you know, very good contextualization and conceptualization of hybrid warfare in the Indian context. But if you look at Indian success story post-independence, one of the most brilliant example of hybrid warfare was offensive hybrid warfare strategy that we had unleashed against Pakistan, right? Now, despite suffering series of defeats, the intransigence of Pakistan or its resilience has not gone down, right? Now, at this juncture, we have two choices, as you enunciated. One is the defensive hybrid warfare strategy, another is offensive hybrid warfare strategy. Now, what is the reach to which you can extend your defensive hybrid strategy? And is there a hope that that kind of an approach would moderate behavior of Pakistan? Or is it good for us, at least if not in intent, in articulation, but in the applied sense, have a very advanced offensive hybrid warfare strategy which we can calibrate?
Good evening, sir. I am Vishal Verba, Deputy Commandant, and I am from NTRO. My question is that my personal opinion, and it's driven by nationalistic approach. I wanted to know your personal view. Don't you think we should implement something like Israel, like making it essential for every government servant to serve at least for 1 or 2 years in army or military services? That way it will cultivate the nationalistic approach also. So I just wanted to know your personal view, or do we have any such plan like Israel?
Ajay Shukla, sir. You very rightly touched on the strength of our narrative as a liberal democracy, as a country that respects freedom and human rights. And the logical sort of corollary of that would be that as a part of our hybrid warfare technique, we also have the means of propagating that ideology, propagating Indian soft power and so on. We've seen countries like the United States, like Russia and so on, they have very powerful broadcast capabilities for broadcasting their perceptions and ideologies. Do you think it's time for India to set up that kind of broadcast capability in the region, where we can spread our views, where we can reach out to people, where we can push forward Indian soft power? And if so, how can we do it?
Sir, I have a question too.
Take on these three first, we'll come back to you. So talking about what General Sharma mentioned about nuanced hybrid warfare strategy, you know, I mentioned two things. I said we can either adopt a defensive strategy or a proactive strategy. Now, or a defensive, offensive, you know, we can keep mingling with these words. But a defensive strategy is certainly something which is the need of the hour. If you have to counter the hybrid warfare, you first have to ensure that your defensive strategy is in place. Because going in for an offensive strategy without having your defensive strategy in place will not work. So I think what has happened is, as far as hybrid warfare is concerned, our defensive strategy is the way we are dealing with hybrid warfare. But is that the best way of dealing with it? You know, we've got embroiled in this hybrid warfare or proxy war or whatever you want to call it for the last 30 years. Has it given us the desired result? I would say only partially. We haven't completely succeeded, at least in the state of J&K. So while our defensive strategy also needs a retweaking, we need to see what we need to do. And that requires imbibing technology for enhancing our defensive hybrid warfare capability. And what are we trying to say by technology? Technology is being able to listen to the people who are orchestrating this hybrid warfare, and then getting on to getting hard intelligence to tackle them. And then at the same time also retain the capability for offensive defense. What I am trying to mean by that is, we must have the capability to hit out at the perpetrators of hybrid warfare across, for which we have to develop capabilities. It's not that we don't have the capabilities. We do have the capabilities, but once we know that we are going to employ those capabilities, we have to be prepared for its escalation. So we have to very carefully prepare our escalation matrix as to how far are we willing to go. Where will we call the end state, and where will we finally think this will lead us to? So defensive and offensive strategy certainly required. Defensive strategy, I think, is doing well, except for that little bit of technological hiccup that are there, which, you know, you have a friend here from NTRO. I think things are working in place now to see that at least the defensive strategy works well. And as far as the offensive strategy is concerned, some plans are there. Some plans need to be further taken forward. But we have to then be prepared for it, to develop, to be prepared to see if it leads on to something bigger. So that is something which we have to be very clear about, that while we may be looking at hybrid warfare as an offensive option, but then we should be prepared for it, for its escalation. And that escalation matrix is something which we have to work out on to see how far and how much can we go. So I think, but what you are saying is absolutely right. Nuanced strategy is required, and I think it's not so bad as it is being made out to be. We do have a strategy for hybrid warfare. I mean, we are countering it, need better options, but to give the other fellow exactly the in the same coin may not be the best options. Let me tell you, anybody who's tried hybrid warfare, a stone that is thrown up in the air finally comes on your head. Any nation which has actually attempted hybrid warfare in another adversary has finally been the sufferer. I think it's been seen the world over, and today Pakistan is facing that brunt. So before we launch the hybrid warfare in the, I would say, the offensive-defensive domain, we should be prepared to see what will happen to those people after the end state has been achieved, or will there be an end state? What do you do with those people? Today, why has Pakistan come into this state? Is because they supported something in Afghanistan, but after the Afghanistan imbroglio got settled, what happened to those people? Those people were there, you know, to be launched anyway, and that is the state that they are in. And this hybrid warfare, while launched by them, has actually started affecting them more than it is affecting us in the long term. So I feel the nuanced strategy must look at all these issues before we go in, but more important would be to have your defensive hybrid strategy in place. Coming down to the whether we should have compulsory service, you know, if you look at our population, we've brought in various kinds of means to see if some kind of disciplining of our population can be carried out, and that is being done through the NCC. Expanding the NCC, I would advocate, yes, there is scope for expanding our NCC. But to make service compulsory for everybody for 1 to 2 years has two pitfalls. One is that look at the size of our population. I don't think the military can take care of that and have people being trained for 2 years. And my second fear is the way the country is going, I'm not very sure whether it is good to have this kind of population which is trained in fighting and firing a weapon. So, you know, we have to look at that issue also, that people who can then very accustomed to firing an AK-47 is also a very dangerous option. So I would say expanding it in the NCC may be a better option. And of course, finally, coming down to Ajay Shukla's question, yeah, absolutely, you're absolutely right. We must leverage our soft power. And let me tell you, to a large extent, soft power presently is being played up by, you know, by, we say, Bollywood is playing soft power. I think we also can play soft power through military diplomacy. We are doing it now. We are now integrating or, you know, looking at our neighbors particularly in seeing how we can, while we carry out military to military contacts with them, how can we bring them to various places in our country where we can play the soft power with them. And if you recall, some months ago we had got some Sri Lankans, took them to Gaya, kept them for a day. It was military people, military person from Sri Lanka who came. Even today, as I speak to you, there are some officers, jawans and families from Bangladesh who are here, heading on their way to see the Taj Mahal. They are back. And similarly, Myanmar, Vietnam, we are looking at all these countries to leverage our soft power. But that is not all. I think propaganda warfare to leverage our soft power is the next issue that we need to address. And I think that will get addressed once we go in for some of the things like indigenization of our weapon systems, our ammunition, all that starts happening. All that will also help us in creating soft power capabilities, because a number of these multinational companies and international agencies will start interacting with us. And not only with the government agencies, but I think the military can play a very important role in propagating not just hard power, but also propagating our soft power. So that I certainly feel needs to be addressed, but I feel that in addition to the government agencies, we also need to use our expertise in developing soft power. Yeah, broadcast capability, I'm telling you, it is required for propaganda, yes. We need to enhance that. As of now, what we've done is we've got into the FM domain. You know, we are trying to do it through the FM domain. But there are certainly means to do it other ways also. You know, like, let me tell you now today, even the TV channels are going international. Today, you know, most of our, some of our TV channels have gone international, and that's the way forward. It's not that you must be seeing CNN and BBC here to see what the British and the US want to propagate and project their soft power, or the you know, the various Chinese channels do to us. I think we also are going international, and that's the way forward. VEON, I think, has now got an international, you know, they've got also one, I mean, they are visible to the international spectrum also. So that way, I think some of our channels going going overseas to propagate our soft power is very important.
Thank you. Next is Mr. Kindly, Professor Luthra, General Astana, and that young lady. Sir, round after this.
Sir, Gulshan Luthra, I'm both a journalist and I'm also with IDSA. To follow on, to follow up the point by Ajay Shukla, I will mention two things. All India Radio actually had a wonderful program in 65 work called Ye Radio Jhootistan Hai. I haven't seen a panel of that. Young boys, but we heard it. Second, Mrs. Indira Gandhi had come to UAE in May 81. I was just then stationed there, and before her visit, the Pakistanis flooded the entire Gulf with cassette tapes having jokes about her. And finally, the UAE government had to step in, call the ambassador, a Pakistani ambassador, reprimanded, and all the Gulf states withdrew those cassettes, Oman to Kuwait. But my point, I have one question. What about capability to deter Pakistan? They'll always be ugly, but we need a very strong punch. What can the armed forces do there? Thank you, sir.
Okay, I'm General Astana from USA. As General mentioned about the offensive defense part of it, now what we are actually projecting is the overt options. I'm sure there must be covert options as well. And I'm sure people who are responsible, they must be working on covert option, and I think a synergy of overt and covert will work. And that's the only way we'll be able to take it on. But a few points I want to flag. Firstly, their leaders have been targeted by the US when they were fighting through strike drones. So are we actually working on strike drones? And indigenous capability of strike drones is a must. I think that is one area where we need to work, although we are trying to buy some as the media puts it up. The second issue is the economic warfare, raising the cost of Pakistan economically so high that they cannot match up. In that, what I want to say is that they are going ahead with nukes. Now, it is symbolic. They may not be able to use it. Where our number of holdings of nukes, especially the tactical nukes, is going down, and it gives a psychological edge, it may be a symbolic edge. But let's say if we start a race like that, economically they will not be able to match, and they are already in economically in a very bad shape. So perhaps this kind of race will also help us out in some manner. Your comments on that.
Yes, that lady there. Please introduce yourself.
Good evening, sir. I am Commander Radha Singh. So while you said that as a nation, our first option should not be to go offensive in this kind of a hybrid conflict. I mean, creating an unrest in our neighborhood should not be our first choice. However, sir, do you feel that an offensive hybrid warfare in the form of a psychological or an information warfare can be unleashed from our own turf? Basically, what I mean to say is the way the adversaries have unleashed the propaganda on our soil, can we counter the same using some means of the hybrid warfare? If yes, sir, what kind of coordination you feel would be required for its execution? Would it be a pure polity affair, or would it be a coordination of a military or a polity affair? Thank you, sir.
Firstly, coming to Mr. Gulshan's question, you know, what you said, what should be the capability to deter Pak? You know, you're talking of hard power. Capability is that you have to have the capability of punitive deterrence against Pakistan. If you have to take on Pakistan, then it can't end in a stalemate. And let me tell you, this kind of deterrence we have. We possess this kind of deterrence. If we have to take the call, it is possible to take that call. So I don't think we should be concerned about the kind of capability we have with Pakistan. We have to be more concerned about the other border. And no, regarding General Stana's question, you know, when you talk of strike drones, how does the Israeli strike the Hezbollah, or how do they do it? You see, they have their sources on ground who pinpoint a vehicle to say that this is the vehicle in which a leader has just come out of a house, and somebody gives the information, and they electronically mark that vehicle, and that vehicle gets marked, and now a drone takes off in the air and hits that vehicle. God help you if you are in the following vehicle, you are also gone. Now this kind of a thing is possible in that area, in that country. In our country, you've seen the kind of repercussions when you you know, the kind of flak that you face when you take such action even against a stone thrower who's carrying out offensive action against you. In our country, you know, the way things are moving, it is very nice to say we need these drones, but will you accept mistakes being committed by such weapon systems? You have to accept it. If the nation will spare us for the kind of mistakes that may get committed using such kind of weapons, then I think we can take a call.
No, I'm talking across. To kill their leaders, basically.
You see, across also there can be mistakes. Either way, whether in your territory or the territory across, there will be mistakes. So if we are willing to accept these mistakes and we feel that there will be no repercussion, there will be no backlash, there is a way forward. It's not that to say we can't use it. That is the reason why we are trying to procure these weapons. But these weapons are being procured more for, not for the hybrid warfare system. We are looking at it from the conventional war. But yes, anything that we procure has got dual use. But the first issue is that the issue of collateral damage. We get so concerned. In your own nation, your people get concerned about collateral damage so much. When you are fighting this kind of warfare, I think you have to accept collateral damage. Collateral damage will happen. It is war. And if that is something which we can accept, then there is just no problem in using these kind of weapon systems. But can we accept it? Will the international community get after us, or will they spare us in case mistakes happen? That is the call that we have to take. Otherwise, there is just no problem in using it. As far as Ms. Radha's question is concerned, I think what you mentioned is exactly what you know, Ajay Shukla mentioned. You know, is psychological warfare through propaganda, through other issues. Yes, we need to develop these capabilities. Some of these capabilities are being developed. And it is not just that it is the Army's requirement. I think now we've created an organization called the NSCN, which has been restructured. And these issues are being addressed there in a very big way, to see how we can carry out propaganda or psychological warfare in concert with all the other agencies, Army being only one of them. Yeah, let's see.
Please, sir, please introduce yourself. Please use the mic.
I'm S.K. Mathur, former ambassador to Norway. I stand in Yugoslavia. I have a straight question to General. Don't you think that a periodical surgical strike will be befitting reply to bring down the morale of Pakistan Army and deter Pakistan? Thank you.
I am Sanjeev Tripathi, former Secretary. We all know that Pakistan has been using these ISI-sponsored terrorists for a proxy war against us, because they feel that it is in their national interest to do so. Now the thing is that besides taking effective countermeasures to thwart such activities within the country, shouldn't we make Pakistan to pay a very heavy price for that, so that they realize that it is no more in their national interest to do so? And that could be done both through covert and overt activities as well as diplomatic activities. Now, the ISI operations here are covert operations, and ISI denies its involvement in that. So don't you think that the response to such covert actions has to be in terms of, preferably in terms of, more effective covert actions on the other side? Now, you also mentioned about the Kashmir. Sometimes I feel that Kashmir word we have been using in different contexts. Sometimes we mean Kashmir Valley, sometimes it means Indian side of Kashmir, and sometimes it is the entire erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir. So problem in Valley and the Kashmir issue, they are actually two different things, though very interconnected. Now POK or Gilgit-Baltistan, if it is a part of India, don't you think that we have to be much more proactive about our claim on POK and also extend all sorts of quote-unquote moral support to the people of that area in their fight against the Pakistani occupation there? And also mention has been made here about the psychological warfare. I think it's an extremely important part of this present day hybrid warfare. Now, psychological, have we done enough in that? I'm afraid we haven't done. And again, this should not appear to be government sponsored, because then its effectiveness will go. It has to be proper operation. The thing is, for example, like even in Kashmir, saying that how Punjabi dominated Pakistan government is treating its ethnic minorities. What happened to Bengalis? What is happening to Pashtuns? What is happening to Balochis? What is happening to even Kashmiris on that side? This has to be properly publicized or propagated in that area. Even in the mainland, that the Muslims who preferred to stay back in India after partition are much better off, sir, than their brothers who went that side. So this type of psychological operations, I would like to have your comments on that.
General Chakravarti, please.
Sir, I am General Chakravarti. I have a very simple question. You brought out that the youth of Kashmir are highly radicalized. Most of them are employed, like Zaki Musa and others, and they are engaging. Two issues which we find were very commonly known. One is that you've got a horde of people who have, you know, been who are in these 700 mosques or so, who have come from outside states, mainly in the Deobandi culture. I think they need to be back to be what you call exported back to the states. It's an internal issue, nothing much. Next is a lot of funding which is going on. I don't know what is being done about this funding, because we have various organizations, but when it comes to ground, we find that people are flush with funds. I'll put it, the best houses are in Kashmir, in Srinagar. And I think Jammu would be next. And I haven't found a beggar in Kashmir. And a marriage festival, as far as I know, I remember attending one, is 54 meat dishes being prepared. And I think the main thing which went on the highway, at least as a general officer I observed, was chickens and meat going from Jammu along with stones. What are we doing to stop these things within our own territory?
Ambassador Mathur's question, you know, should we periodically deter? You know, you would have often heard statements coming out from military commanders, we had done that, we had done that also. So let's not, not believe that the Indian armed forces just sit on their side of the border. I leave it at that. And that, periodically things don't happen. So I think the lesser said the better, but quite frankly, you heard the statement that before the surgical strike, somebody said, oh, this was also done by me, I had also done that. So to say that this has not been a periodic thing is something which, once in a while things do happen. But that is where I would leave it. Talking about, national interests, effective countermeasures, teach Pakistan lesson through covert overt means. What are the means that we have used? So far we have used a very defensive strategy in dealing with this proxy war. We've been completely defensive. Terrorists keep coming. We thought we'll be able to sort this problem, resolve the problem out through countering terrorism and countering the insurgency there. If you notice, we have been able to succeed to a large extent from time to time. Insurgency that started with Octopac in December 89 has had its ups and downs. We came down to a situation where we thought things have become hunky-dory. The only thing is that when things become hunky-dory and things become comfortable, we've gone into a kind of a limbo thinking that peace has returned, not knowing that every time this peace returns, the nexus has utilized this period to rebuild their capacities and strength, and therefore sustained pressure is required. If you put sustained pressure for some time, then carry out the other activities simultaneously with it, I think you'll have an effect. What I am trying to highlight is, you get one successful year and you say, let's give
peace a chance. That is, I think, a fault that we've been committing. If you think that by just having one good successful year you can give peace a chance, that may not be the best option. You have to get repeated successes and then think of giving peace a chance. And I think that is what we are doing now. Let us look at tiring the other side. Let us look at, see how much can he sustain. Once we have taken that action, then simultaneously we should see that how the other issues of administration, governance and everything can happen. But one issue where I think there is a shortfall and which we need to address is the propaganda and social media issues. The manner in which radicalization has happened, and somebody also said that so many Maulvis have come from outside. Yes, they have come from outside. How did this happen? It was a very gradual influx, a very planned strategy which was being done, where first 5 people came in a year, then 20 came, then somebody went outside, got indoctrinated. Some of them went for the Hajj, got indoctrinated there and came back. So that is how gradual transformation of the of these mosques have taken place, and outsiders have come in with some of them with radical ideologies. The monitoring of all these is taking place. You know, you suddenly can't just turn them over. So you are taking care of them. You are finding that those people who are propagating extreme ideologies are being booked and taken to task. Those with not so extreme ideologies are being convinced to see that they follow moderate ideologies. It's not that everybody will become a Sufi saint there. It won't happen. So, but we have to see that they start following moderate ideologies. So there is a line being drawn as to what is moderate, and those who are crossing that threshold of moderation are being taken to task. It's not that they're all being allowed to continue to operate in the way they feel and that there is free for all happening there. No, it's not happening. Regarding covert and overt actions, yes, you can take covert actions, you can take overt actions. Both options are possible and have to be done. From time to time, you have to do some covert, some overt. That has to be done. But as I said, every time you do an action, you must succeed. So therefore, it is not just to say that just do some covert action, just do some overt action. If you are not going to succeed in your actions, then it's going to have, it is futile. So every action that you plan must be so planned that it gives you a reasonable degree of success and it hurts the other fellow. So that is the issue that is involved with covert and overt action. It is not just saying that we can do a large number of covert actions or overt actions, but the success rate is 10%. That is not worth it. It is, the success rate has to be measured, and only then must you carry out these operations. Psychological warfare, I think, well said. I think started with Ajay Shukla saying that your propaganda, your everything. Yes, psychological warfare has to be taken to the next plane. And all agencies have to be involved in developing psychological warfare options in Kashmir. Otherwise, without that, you will not succeed. As I said, Kashmir does not have the problems that are made out to be. Today, if you look at what is happening in Kashmir, they said there is governance is lacking. I mean, one of the demands from the Kashmiris, that is lack of governance, good governance. So we said, okay, let's do Panchayati Raj. Let's go for Panchayati Raj. You do your own governance. What did the Kashmiris do? They wanted to boycott the Panchayat elections. How have the elections happened and what has been the success of the elections is for you to read and see. The people want Panchayati Raj because they feel that if governance comes to the hand, this is a good way forward. If there has been low voting turnout, it has been low voting has been in those areas where during the time of the elections, continuous operations were being launched. These operations were being launched to ensure that in no way there is disruption in the political process or the election process or in the electionary. People are free to come out and vote, but operations had to be conducted. So in a particular area where operations were being conducted, possibly people didn't come out. Otherwise, you look at the success of the Panchayat. So the Panchayati election is one of the way forward of giving them good governance, administration in their own hands. And I think it's been a fairly successful thing that has happened in spite of all the reservations and whatever we had about these elections, they've happened. The other issue is employment generation. People say there is lack of employment in Jammu and Kashmir. On the one hand, the grievance of the people is lack of employment opportunities. On the other hand, the same people are coming to the police and saying, leave the police. I mean, is there a dichotomy in what is happening? So you see the dichotomy that is coming in from within. One element says there is lack of job opportunities, but when you carry out police recruitment, there are lines and lines of people coming in for recruitment, and yet there are threats being given to the same policemen to leave the police force. But when the lines are coming in for police recruitment, that time nobody is coming and killing the people and saying don't come for the recruitment, or massacre 50 of them and say why have you come for recruitment. It's not happening. So if you see, there is a very small percentage of people who are actually disrupting their life in Kashmir. It's not the large masses as we believe it to be, that the whole thing has gone topsy-turvy. It is a small percentage, but yes, the radicalization of the youth has happened. Radicalization of youth, because come 2:30 in the afternoon, 3:30, people are back from school, colleges, wherever they are. There's nothing else to do other than watch the television and look at your mobile phones, because it is there, and read messages. And what do these messages convey? Everything negative and falsehood. So a lot of things is being propagated through falsehood. That is what is happening in the Kashmir Valley. Then they say there is no development. What is the meaning of development? Development will only come with peace. If there is peace, the people will come. The other issue is about job opportunity and amalgamation. You know, in the Kashmir Valley, as we rightly said, there has been no death due to cold injuries. There is no death due to hunger. So it is not that the people are not being cared for. The best villas are coming up in Kashmir and continue to come so day after day, both inside and outside the valley. So are the people short of funds? Is there a lack of government has pumped in enough? There is adequate for everybody? Yes, there is poverty. There is a difference between the rich and the poor. But it is something which is comparable with the rest of the country. But unfortunately, what has happened in Kashmir, the people, because of the falsehood that has been propagated, that Kashmiris are being some people who are discriminated against, they are treated differently, is a falsehood and propaganda which we have to take care of to counter. It is not so. I mean, today there are people with the same discrepancies in other parts of our country. Have they taken to the gun? They haven't. To say that in the state of UP or any other state that we look at, for that matter even Punjab, there is no unemployment. There is unemployment in Punjab. But have the people taken to such a radical course as to take the gun against the state? It hasn't happened. In Kashmir, it is only happening because of radicalization, and because somehow the people who are taking the gun are being treated as you know, martyrs once they die, or freedom fighters when they fight. This is the false set of propaganda which is being propagated in the Kashmir Valley. But let me tell you one thing, the sense is also dawning on the Kashmiri people to say that this is not the right way forward. And that, I think, is happening, what we have witnessed in the panchayat elections, where we are also seeing the mothers now giving calls to their wards to come back and shun the gun. This has started happening. Let me tell you, if the successful operations are happening today in the valley, how are they happening? It is happening through hard intelligence. Who's providing this intelligence? The same people. The same people who feel the terrorist should not be in my neighborhood is telling you that here is the terrorist, come and kill him. It's the same people who we feel have been radicalized. So it is not so that things have gone completely out of control in the valley. Things will be brought into control and are being brought under control. But sustained pressure needs to be maintained. It should not happen that little bit of peace that we see and we say, oh, things are hunky-dory, now is the time to return to barracks and let things happen. Gentlemen, this time will be used for revamping the network of the terrorists. You have to bring them to a level where they are not able to revamp, get the leadership out and make sure that there are very few weapons left with them, and they do not have opportunities to carry out conglomeration and get together wherever they want to. But the one issue that we are now addressing and needs to be addressed is funeral processions. In the funeral processions, when you make a martyr of a terrorist, is what is possibly encouraging more people to join the terrorist ranks. So as gradually we start diminishing these processions, that fervor will also come down. So there are some of the issues which we are gradually addressing. We don't want to come with a heavy hand and then allow that to become a trigger for further violence in the valley. So gradually things are being taken step by step, so that no trigger is provided for them to again escalate, because from the other side they are looking for a trigger. And that trigger is what we have to avoid. I think there was a question that came on. So I had a question. I'm sorry, I missed your questions, or have I answered it? I actually mixed up all the questions.
By and large, you have answered it. But one thing I just asking.
I now got this question. You know, when we said is it just Kashmir Valley, JNK, which is part of us, or JNK other side? Well, we do claim the entire JNK state as being part of us. While we claim that state as being part of us, I think first let us resolve what is with us. I mean, let's get control of what is with us than looking across. So first we should look at this, At the same time, I'm not saying that we should lose sight of the other side. We should not lose sight of the other side. And therefore, every time something happens on our side, we must always address it to say that this effect is also going to have a radical effect on the other side. But the issue is, on the other side, the complete demography has changed. Pakistan has very cleverly changed the complete demography of so-called Pakistan, occupied Kashmir, Gilgit, Baltistan. So one is not very sure as to who's an actual Kashmiri, whom are you addressing this issue to? Is he a Kashmiri or is he a Punjabi who's come in there and is occupying those areas? People from Gilgit, Baltistan are also being now taken over gradually. So, you know, to say that, there is identity between our side of Kashmir and the Pakistan side of Kashmir, I think that identity thing has gradually been eroded very cleverly by the Pakistanis. And that is an issue which we have to look at. So I think, but first I feel, let's take control of our own part of the Kashmir, bring it under control, get the system moving there, and then start looking at things across.
Sir, I have got one question, sir.
Who is this, please?
Me, sir.
Last question, we are totally out of time. Sir. Last question.
I'll just take 15 seconds, sir. Sir, in this hybrid conflict which is going on, I'm Kanil Laljit Prasad, sir. I'm with NTRO and I'm an analyst with them. In JNK, sir, one very potent force in combating hybrid conflict is understanding the various faces of Islam, sir. What I mean is, who is Behrelvi or who is Salafi? Are we having any kind of such structured training for our own people who understand and can utilize them? Because in 2003 and 4, sir, in the election of JNK provincial elections, the student court used to initially have only 18-19% turnout, and that was the year it had 82% in that subdivision. And one man was responsible for it, the Mufti of the Student Court Masjid. He was talked 2 days behind and he was told the importance. He said the same thing in the Takreer. What I request and want to know, sir, are we having similar kind of a thing wherein we try to get to know about them and utilize them for combating their mindset?
See, firstly, as far as the army in particular is concerned, all army people who go into Kashmir Valley, you know, they go to a pre-induction training, and during that pre-induction training they are taught the tenets of Islam and what kind of Islam is actually being followed in Kashmir. So our officers and some men do have basic knowledge of Islam. It's not that they are completely diverse from the from what they are entering into, and they do carry out some language training also. So the kind of Islam that is to be propagated in the valley is known to them. Unfortunately, what's happened is today, with the way the internet has proliferated and the way the social media has proliferated, somehow you find that more and more people are getting attracted to IS ideology. And you find that at times you even find that IS black flag coming there. When you speak to the Kashmiris, do you understand the IS ideology? The answer is very different. It is not IS ideology they talk of. In fact, when we tell them, okay, why don't you all fly the IS flag on top of your houses and get IS ideology here and start adopting that ideology, they say, what does it mean? We say, it means that no ladies in schools, no ladies in jobs, no teachers, no lady teachers, all of you wear the burqa, no television sets, no Indian movies. They said, no, this is not what we mean. And I said, why do you fly this black flag? He said, we fly this black flag because somehow it irritates the security forces. So that is their concept of that IS. The IS concept is that that black flag flying or that Pakistani flag flying irritates the security forces. So they feel this is a source of irritation, and they find anything, they have been told that the Indian security forces are actually an occupation force and they are your enemies. So irritate them in whatever way you can. So sometimes that black flag is thrown with that that idea. When you ask them Azadi, they don't understand the meaning of Azadi. What is Azadi for them? Azadi for them means that there are no bunkers on the roads, there are no military people, they can go to school on time. We say, yes, there are no gun running people. That is Azadi for them. Azadi is not what we feel is Azadi. So really speaking, a Kashmiri himself is confused. Most Kashmiris themselves are confused on their religion, on their actual religion. You know, Kashmiriyat has now found many definitions. What is Kashmiriyat? Anybody will give you any number of definitions of Kashmiriyat. It is as difficult to actually identify as it is to identify terrorism, you know. What is the definition of terrorism is as difficult to possibly as it is to define Kashmiriyat today. That is what is happening. So really speaking, yes, there is some kind of thing, and even with the Maulvis who are coming in there, some kind of you know, thing has happened that we are training them. We even get Maulvis together in Sadbhavana tours together. We get whole lot of them, take them to Ajmer Sharif, take them to Agra, show them what is there in India to show that you know, the there is no prosecution of any community or any religious minority in India. That is being propagated by getting these Maulvis out of Kashmir and taking them on tours around Indian cities where the you know, the Muslim mosques are there, where the Muslim artifacts are there. So they are being shown all this.
I know there are a number of questions, I can see some hands, but we are totally out of time. It just remains for me to thank the Chief of the Army Staff for coming here this afternoon and sharing his views so openly with us about the situation on the ground and his perceptions about how we should deal with this. On behalf